Income, sale of tickets, $17. Donation from Sam Patch Memorial Jumping Society, $1,000. Total, $1,017. Expenses, park, $5. Prizes, bunting, etc., $12. Administrative expenses, $1,000. Total, $1,017. Net profit, nil.
I move the report be seconded.
I think the dog already did earlier.
There you go, we keep the archives.
I'd like to give the report on the games and races now.
Louder.
Boo. The 25-yard dash for boys under 6 was won by Ron Tanner. The 25-yard dash for girls under 6 was won by Robin and Allison Urquhart. The 50-yard dash for boys under 12 was won by Michael McKenzie.
He's 13.
And the 50-yard dash for girls under 12 by Allison Urquhart. The ladies' kick the shoe was first place Linda McKenzie and second place Judy McKenzie, I have here. Fifth place. The no running jump for under 6 was won by Allison McKenzie, and sixth was Nathaniel Craig. The no running jump for under 12 was won by Allison Urquhart. The no running jump open was won by Greg Curnow, and Carolyn Denny placed sixth. The three-legged race was won by Greg and Sheila Curnow. The two-legged race was won by Jeff and Janet, and second was Chris and Jim. The one-legged race was won by Jim Cairns.
Don't do that, Laura.
The no-legged race was won by Ron and Ron Tanner. And as you know, the Exley jumping, the junior division was won by Lori Androwski, and the senior division was won by Jim Cairns. And that concludes the games report. And now, at this time, I'd like to ask people to introduce speakers. I might say beforehand that the first speaker has requested that he not be interrupted in the course of his speech, but has promised to allow time for challenges and questions afterward. Bernice Vincent will introduce the first speaker.
Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to introduce to you my husband, Don Vincent.
I'll keep it short. Can't see you.
Everybody stand up.
Nora.
I haven't interrupted you.
Come on.
Speaker like a glass of water.
It's a guru type speech.
This is show speech.
Now that the speech is over, I'd like to challenge you.
We have that in French as well.
She just got knocked
down. A real tearjerker. Be still.
Nora. I'm afraid to get up.
Here, I'll get her.
I can't move her. This ain't fun.
Be still.
No throwing tomatoes.
Sit down now, behave yourself.
No, stand up.
Won't
be standing up all of a sudden.
Come on.
Did you
fall over?
That would start the speaker to move it anyway, wouldn't it? No power! Challenges or questions now accepted.
Oh!
Well, did you ever notice what happens to England whenever they have a leader named Harold? All the pollution in the United States is not in the rivers and streams.
I don't see why John Ball's question is
pertinent. Have you asked John the name he has chosen for his, if he has a child?
If you keep that child quiet, please.
I'd now like to ask Mr. Hugh McIntyre to introduce the next speaker.
Bonjour. From the President du Parti Nihiliste du Canada, je voudrais souhaiter bienvenue à nos amis étrangers qui ont voyagé 500 000 pour nous joindre ici aujourd'hui. Maintenant, je voudrais présenter Monsieur Pierre Théberge, qui va nous donner un discours. Pierre?
Chers frères séparés de l'Amérique, c'est avec une joie, une émotion que nous ne pouvons décrire que nous sommes aujourd'hui parmi vous. Ici, dans ces ex-colonies françaises qui nous ont un jour appartenu, nous marchons dans ces champs verdoyants et après deux siècles de séparation, nous nous retrouvons ensemble. C'est ainsi que nous, Français, nous avons perdu l'Empire, mais nous avons gardé notre âme, tandis que vous, Anglo-Saxons, vous avez gagné l'Empire, mais avez-vous perdu votre âme? Nous avons gardé le flambeau de la race et nous allons continuer à le tenir bien haut, car après ce long périple, nous sommes venus, nous avons voyagé pendant une journée à travers ces plaines, ces montagnes, ces collines. Nous avons vu ces vaches, ces troupeaux dans cette belle terre prospère anglo-saxonne. Et nous sommes émus. Nous sommes... Notre joie est inexprimable d'être parmi vous. Nous espérons que ces vallées resteront prospères, que ces champs continueront à produire et que nous, un jour, serons ensemble un seul pays, une seule nation. Vive la France, vive le Québec, vive l'Ontario, vive le Parti nihiliste et surtout, vive T-Pop. Merci.
He is French.
Yeah, but I say he was trembling in French.
Mais non. I'd like to call upon Mr. William A. Exley to introduce our last speaker for the day.
Where's my speech?
It's gone on.
It's my pleasure to make one of the speeches of introduction this afternoon. I'd like to begin this speech of introduction by recounting a brief and true anecdote from my personal life.
Hey, Jerry,
When I was a young man attending secondary school, my mother, who at times was very disturbed by my lack of personal religiosity, often berated me on my seemingly errant philosophy of living. It was at that time that the column Thoughts of a Teenager appeared in the London Free Press. And my mother often said to me, in this time when she was rather distraught, words of this sort: "Why can't you think like that young man who writes that column in the paper?" It was many years later, at the home of a mutual friend, that I finally met the author of that column. And the author was Roy N.W. MacDonald, who I'd like to introduce to you this afternoon.
Hello. When Greg Curnow asked me to come and speak, he told me it could be serious or humorous, or I could say whatever I wanted to say. And he told me to talk about something that was of current interest to me. So I'd like to begin by saying that what happened to me 3 days ago, I want to talk about. I went to a party, and at the party, I met a girl. This girl had taken LSD about an hour before that, and we communicated non-verbally. We communicated just simply through being together. She did not allow words to interfere with awareness of reality.
I've done that too, girl. On two occasions.
And the evening ended up by, she gave me a flower, a rose. I think this was very beautiful. Now, what I... The subject of my talk is silence. I would like to speak to you about the nonverbal. I have a friend who said he is a person who could see on his tombstone written the words, "Here is a man who spent his life talking about the nonverbal." He was very good at theorizing, at realizing the value of immediate awareness of reality, and without allowing words to get in between him and reality. Now, what I'm saying has been said before by the anonymous writers of the Upanishads, by the Buddha, by Jesus, by the Sufi mystics, by Suzuki, Alan Watts, Walt Whitman, and so on. The message has been heard at all times and all places. It's what Aldous Huxley has called the perennial philosophy. The message is extremely simple. It is so simple that most people cannot comprehend it. Because of the brainwashing and hypnosis of society, it is the hardest thing in the world for most people to be simple and to allow themselves to be directly aware of reality. Most people are either verbalizing, talking to somebody else, or talking to themselves about reality. They allow the words to get between themselves and the reality it represents. Artists do the same thing, only they do it with painting. The important thing is direct awareness of the reality, of the here and now. Now, the hardest thing in the world is for people to be simple. This depends on purity of heart. And Jesus had said, "Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God." There is no other way of seeing God. Children are pure in heart. And Jesus said, except ye become as a little child, ye shall not enter into the kingdom of heaven. This purity of heart is the understanding and awareness of immediate reality, being able to sense one's body and the world around oneself, to sense the beauty of nature and not be constantly verbalizing about the world. I think the greatest books, like the greatest poems, are those that point the way to the mystery of being. To do this, one needs to be open to experience. The greatest books, the greatest poems point the way to silence. In the heart of everything is silence. And in the deepest heart of our being is this silence, which is the silence, the mystery of being. You've heard the expression, the syllables Om, A-U-M, a chant. People chant this over and over to attain enlightenment. This is in the Hindu tradition. Before the beginning of the Om and after the end of the word is the silence. This is the silence of the world of reality as we see it, without structuring reality by talking about it. Most of the time our words get between ourselves and the reality. Now I want to close by reading something to you from a book by Ronald Lang called The Politics of Experience. He is a psychiatrist, and this is the end of his book, the last two paragraphs. Can you hear me all right, everybody? Okay. After I'm finished, you may ask me any questions. I have seen the bird of paradise. She has spread herself before me. Pardon? I have seen the bird of paradise. She has spread herself before me, and I shall never be the same again. There is nothing to be afraid of. Nothing. Exactly. The life I am trying to grasp is the me that is trying to grasp it. There is really nothing more to say when we come back to that beginning of all beginnings. That is nothing at all. Only when you begin to lose that Alpha and Omega do you want to start to talk and to write. And then there is no end to it. Words, words, words. At best and most, they are perhaps in memoriam. Evocations, conjurations, incantations, emanations, shimmering iridescent flares in the sky of darkness. A just, still feasible tact. Indiscretions, perhaps forgivable. City lights at night from the air, receding like these words. Atoms, each containing its own world and every other world, each a fuse to set you off. If I could turn you on, if I could drive you out of your wretched mind, if I could tell you, I would let you know. In conclusion, Buddha's most important sermon was not the various things that he said to his disciples, not his spoken words. At the end of his greatest sermon, Buddha stood before his audience and simply showed his disciples a flower. This is the rose the girl gave to me the other night. A flower. When Buddha gave the flower, what he was saying silently is that the important thing is the moment, the here and now, the reality that exists here. This is where the kingdom of heaven is, on this earth now, and one needs to be aware of the reality, and as I say, not allow the words to get in between man and the world. Words are useful, words need to be used, but we need to get beyond words. As Ludwig Wittgenstein said at the end of his Tractatus, whereof one cannot speak, thereof one must remain silent. Remain silent. The last word, silence, and then the reality.
It's interesting, and in fact, Ludwig Wittgenstein said at the end of the Tractatus, oh shit, I'll never finish it. Send it to the publisher like it is.
Are there any questions?
Mr. Boyle will be granted equal time for a rebuttal.
I have to make a speech this year, so I thought it would be a golden opportunity to make a speech.
May I answer your rebuttal?
No.
Yeah. Oh, God, it's what pen is it this year?
Mr. Chairman, presidents,
out of order,
fellow speakers, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, homosexuals, mesdames et messieurs, enfants, homosexuels, quand je marche dans la vallée de l'ombre de la mort, fellow nihilists, this year I was not invited to speak at the nihilist picnic.
Yay!
I felt, however, that recent events necessitated a clear reaffirmation of the philosophy and policies of my faction of the nihilist party of the world, that is, the extreme right wing of the party. The developments in Czechoslovakia, in Chicago, in Miami, in Bramley, in Berkeley, in St. Paul, in Moravian Town, I could go on and on. In Montreal, in Edinburgh, in London, in Paris, these developments demonstrate a crying need in the world today and draw the minds of great men to the vacuo sinecure of the universe, questing reaffirmation. My faction is a progressive faction. And yet we do not forget the contributions of those who have gone before. We are a progressive conservative faction. But the winds of change waft gentle in the trees. The chimes of time ring out the news.
And soon we'll have a horse of a different color.
Another day is done, in the words of the bard. Do not be disheartened, for I bring hope to you.
Hey, it's raining!
It's raining! No secret. I suggest we walk out!
Last year, Dr. Kurno suggested the manufacture and distribution of mind-detonating devices. He was speaking semaphorically, of course. The key to personal nihilism lies in self-denigration, self-effacement, self-denial, masochism, if you like. The purging of the mind. All information is irrelevant and irreverent. All information is correlative to prejudice. All prejudices are hirsute. All prejudices are executive powers that govern our behavior in all conceivable circumstances. All prejudices are legislative forces that determine the nature of all conceivable situations. All prejudices are administrative centers that determine the course of our energies. All prejudices are judiciary bodies that decide the direction and constitution of our actions.
The time of the demonstration will fire out of the fire!
From all realities that surround us, from the world, we must undirect and undress ourselves, not with a view to gaining direction, but with a view to making ourselves confident. We
shapeless, mindless, armless, thalidomide, protoplasmic blob. History has demonstrated time and again that nothing is achieved through human enterprise or ambition. The execution of enterprise and the fulfillment of ambition. Perhaps this would be palatable if it were not for the consequent frustration of the hopes of all other persons whose prejudices are in conflict with those of the activists. For the pain and suffering that result from the conflict, we must destroy prejudice. There can be no substitution, no amalgamation, no conciliation, no
substitution.
Hi, guys.